Baptism doesn't happen until after you believe. You will not find one instance where anybody in this entire Bible takes a baby and dunks them in the water or sprinkles them and say they baptize them. Not one. Not one. So if it's not in the Bible, should we do it? No. Well, today, I want us to look at baptism. Now, in baptism, you know, we call it an ordinance in the Baptist church. In the Catholic church and some other denominations, they call it sacraments. But we don't call it sacraments. We call it an ordinance because it's an ordinance because it is a practice that demonstrates our faith. And this is very important to catch, folks. There's a lot of people who think that when you get baptized is when you get saved. No. You are saved before baptism occurs. That's how it works. That's how it works. There's a lot of people who fail to see that. And our baptism is sort of the ritualistic aspect and the Lord's Supper of Ephesians 2:10 that says there are good works that are going to come out from you after salvation. You know that, don't you? There are good works that are going to come out from you, from your life. If there are no good works coming out from your life, then you got to ask yourself, did you get saved? Do you even know Him? Because a lot of people make a profession, but that doesn't mean nothing. God had to do something within your heart. God had to change you from the inside out. But these are the good works which God hath before ordained that we should walk in them. And these ordinances, we said last time, were determined by three factors. First of all, it was instituted by Jesus Christ. Did Jesus Christ institute baptism? Yes, He did. He said, go ye therefore into all the earth and baptize, didn't He? He said that. It was taught by the apostles. It was practiced by the early church. As I said, Jesus commanded this to occur in Matthew 28:19. Let's go over there just a second. Chapter 28, in verse 19 and 20. If you'll stand for the reading of God's Word today. The Scripture says, go ye therefore. That's talking to you, church. That's talking to you. Go ye therefore and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost. All nations, all people groups, all different people, teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I've commanded you. And lo, I am with you always, even unto the end of the world. Amen. You may be seated. Let's pray. Lord God, we come before your throne this morning praising your holy name and thanking you, Lord, that there are some souls today that are going to go through the waters of baptism, going through this ordinance that you instituted within the church. Lord, I pray as I go through this simple message today, Lord, that people will understand the true and the false. Lord, there are many things out in this world today that are false. There's a lot of false things in this world today. Things that weren't ever in the Bible. Things that people put in the Bible. Things that people add to the Bible. And Lord, you said not to add nor take away from your words. And God, I believe that. I believe that because it's in your word. We have one truth, one absolute truth, and it's in the word of God. We pray, God, that you would guide us, that you would give me direction, Lord. Put me out of the way, Lord. Let you speak today. Lord, this isn't just a baptism service. It could be a salvation service today. Lord, if the people would just let the Holy Spirit fall upon them this morning. God, I pray that you help us and you guide us in this service. In Jesus' blessed name, amen. Amen. All right, folks. I want to tell you this morning about three false teachings and two true teachings about baptism. Because there's a lot of false teaching when it comes to baptism. I was told a story about an old drunk. I was looking it up just a little while ago. They're this old drunk, and you know, used to, they baptize out along the riverbank. And while they were out there, people just come out. I reckon our association's going to do that here soon. They're going to have an associational-wide baptismal service by the riverbank. Well, this old drunk was walking by, and he was watching all the different people get baptized. And he come down there, and he was walking down towards the preacher, and he just walked right out there in the water where they're baptizing. And while he was out there in the water, the preacher found him and said, son, do you want to be saved? He said, yeah. I said, do you want to find Jesus? He said, yeah. I said, okay. He said, he brought him over and he dipped him down in the water. He said, did you find Jesus? He said, no. He took him again. He dipped him down one more time.
And he held him down a little longer. He put him back up. He said, did you find Jesus? And he said, no. He said, he held him down one more time. And he held him down there a little longer. He brought him back. Did you find Jesus? And he looked at him and said, no. Are you sure this is where he fell in at? Folks, we've got a lot of false teachings about baptism. You aren't bad. When you get into this water, that's not what saves you. But there are many people that teach this first false teaching. Water baptism is required for salvation. It's true. The people say this. They say this. And I want to look, just look at five verses on this little section here. First, in Mark 16:16. In Mark 16:16, it says, he that believeth and is baptized shall be saved, but he that believeth not shall be damned. And when you first hear that, you're like, oh my goodness. He that believeth and is baptized shall be saved. Does that mean you've got to be baptized to be saved? No. What did the next part say? But he that believeth not shall be damned. It didn't say he that believeth not and is not baptized shall be damned, did it? You see how people can twist the Scripture? They can turn it to what they want to say. You've got to let the Scripture speak for itself. This is the authority. Amen? This is the authority. Not me, not you, not even the government. This is the authority, is the Word of God. The baptism is that natural outworking. This is what you do. If you got saved, you're going to go be baptized. That's what God commanded you to do. There was a long time when I first got saved, I didn't get baptized because I was just a kid and I was kind of scared of water. I still am a little bit. You may see my knees knocking as I walk down this water today. But I was kind of scared of water and I was working out things. But the Scripture here is clear that that's what's going to come. That's some of the things that's ordained that you're going to do. That you're going to be baptized. But that's not a requirement. If so, we've got to tell that poor thief on the cross that Jesus lied to him, right? Because he looked over at that thief on the cross and he said, this day you will be with me in paradise. And nobody come up with a bucket and immersed him in water, did he? No. Nobody baptized him. But that's one of the verses they use. Another one, write this down, and you can look over it later. Galatians 3:27. For as many of you as have been baptized into Christ have put on Christ. Now the whole book of Galatians is about not adding anything, not no works add on to your salvation whatsoever. Can I tell you something? There's two baptisms that are talked about in the Bible. You hear me? There are two baptisms. One is this water baptism. It is a symbolic showing of the first baptism. There is a baptism called the baptism of the Holy Spirit. When you received Jesus Christ as your Savior, you had the baptism of the Holy Spirit fall upon you. You were completely immersed in Him. He saved every part of you and He baptized you. The Scripture also talks about John the Baptist. He said this. He said, there's one coming after me that will not baptize with water, but will baptize with the Holy Ghost and with fire. Folks, either you're going to be baptized with the Holy Ghost when you're saved, or there's going to come a day of judgment and God's going to baptize you with fire, with hell, with judgment. There's one or there's the other. Do you hear me? That ain't popular, but that's true. That's true. Galatians 3:27, that's one of them. To show you that this is talking about that baptism of the Holy Spirit, there's another verse in 1 Corinthians 12:13 that speaks about this also. It says, for by one Spirit are we all baptized into one body, whether we be Jews or Gentiles, whether we be bond or free, and have all been made to drink into one Spirit. If you're here and you're a saved child of God today, then you have been baptized in the Holy Spirit. And the next step is to be baptized in water. That's just the next thing you do. That's what Jesus commanded us to do. It's a thing of obedience. You see? A thing of obedience. Well, another verse they use is Acts 22:16. Paul is describing the time that he was saved. And he says that Ananias looked at him and said, and now why tarriest thou? Arise and be baptized and wash away thy sins, calling on the name of the Lord. See, here's another one. You hear that and you think, well, I'm going to wash away my sins because I'm baptized? No. What did it say? You're washing away your sins because you called on the name of the Lord. Folks, you see how easy you can be led into falsehood? You see how easily that can occur? In Acts 2:38, when Peter's up preaching, he's preaching this great sermon and thousands were baptized after this, saved and baptized. He read this, he said,
Then said Peter said unto them, Repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins. And ye shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. They use that and say, well, look here. It says, be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins. Is that what's occurring there? Well, here's the thing. If you read something, you know, I can prove to you that God is not real. It says in the Scripture, there is no God, right? But before that, it says the fool has said in his heart, there is no God. You've got to read the whole book. You've got to read the whole passage. It all goes together. It all goes together. And if you go down a little bit farther in that particular reading, in Acts 2:41, it says, they that gladly received His word were baptized. You see, it's always after you receive His word that you get baptized. That's just the natural outfit of it. But the baptism isn't what saves you. One more verse that's twisted out that I want to share with you today is 1 Peter 3:21. You can write that down, 1 Peter 3:21. It says, the like figure, whereunto even baptism doth also now save us. And then it says here in the parentheses, not putting away of the filth of the flesh, but the answer of a good conscience toward God by the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Those parentheses are in there and an explanation of what they're saying. Not putting away the filth of the flesh. I can take you through these waters of baptism, and you might come out like you just got a brand new bath. And that's all you did. Because that was all that occurred. It didn't symbolize anything that happened in your heart. There are a lot of Baptists today that just got wet. They just got wet. They didn't have, there was no truth in what happened. And let me tell you what, if you've been saved, I've been baptized twice. I made sure that it was after my salvation. I wanted to make sure of that because that's what the Scripture says. Do you hear me? I wanted to make sure of what that was. But he says not the putting away of the filth of the flesh, not just getting the dirt off of you, but the answer of a good conscience toward God. See, folks, baptism isn't what saves you. The baptism of the Holy Ghost is what saves you. So that's one. Water baptism is required for salvation. That's a false teaching. Another one is babies can be baptized. Now, in a Baptist church, we believe in credo baptism. Not pedo baptism. You say, what in the world kind of pig Latin is he talking about? That is, and it is Latin, by the way. It is Latin. They use that. Credo means that you expressed a creed. You've spoken and you said that you have believed something. Pedo baptism is when you have a baby that's being baptized. So this is a tradition that come up in Christian churches for a long time. And they believe by christening a baby beforehand that somehow they're sealing that child for salvation later on. Folks, that's not true. Now, you can have a dedication service, which is very good. All of my boys have been dedicated. We had a little dedication service with them, and we had everybody come out and prayed on them and different things like that. But baptism doesn't happen until after you believe. You will not find one instance where anybody in this entire Bible takes a baby and dunks them in the water or sprinkles them and say they baptized them. Not one. Not one. So if it's not in the Bible, should we do it? No. If it's not in the Bible, listen to this. Acts 8:37 says this. Philip met this Ethiopian eunuch, and they asked him, they said, what must I do to be baptized? This is very clear, isn't it? And he said in Acts 8:37, and Philip said, if thou believest with all thine heart, thou mayest. And he answered and said, I believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. I believe He's the Son of God. In the book of Acts, there's this whole family that after they believe, they get baptized. All throughout the Scripture, after you believe, you get baptized. Is there somebody here today? Don't raise your hand. But you believed on Jesus Christ, but you haven't been baptized. You're in rebellion against what God's Word says. You are supposed to come forward and begin to join the church and be these good works coming out from you. I fear for you. I do. I fear for you. If you go around with a confession, but you never do anything with it. Jesus said that the good works come out of your faith. There'll be something come out, right? Amen. Does anybody hear me? There'll be something come out of you. There'll be something. There'll be a desire to get in and work in God's house.
There'll be a desire to do what God has called you to do. He made you into a new creature, not so you can sit around and wait till He comes and carries you away, but so you can be used in this world for Him. For Him. Isn't that what your heart should be? And not about ourselves? That's what we fall into. About ourselves. But we've been saved for a reason. So babies cannot be baptized. Nowhere is infant baptism mentioned in the Bible. Thirdly, sprinkling is a correct mode of baptism. Now this one has been in church history for years. Years upon years they've talked about how they would take and they'd sprinkle. It was so bad that there were certain Baptists when they talked about how you're supposed to be completely dunked in the water. There was a group that said, okay, you want to be completely dunked in the water? They took those preachers out there and they drowned them. They drowned them. But here's the thing, and even in our Bibles you can see this. The actual word baptize is a transliteration. Say, my goodness, Scott, there's a $5 word. A transliteration. It is actually taken that actual Greek word and bring it up. The Greek word is baptismo. You know why they done that? Because King James believed in sprinkling. And so to guard themselves, they just, and not to offend God Himself, but also not to offend the king, they wrote down baptize. Baptize. And it actually word, this word baptismo in Greek means to submerge. To completely cover. Now, why is that important? Well, you see, there's other scriptures, which I'm going to look at here in just a minute, that talk about the baptism of the Holy Spirit that I told you about a while ago. When Jesus come, and He came into your heart, did He just sprinkle a little Holy Ghost on you and that was all it was? Did He just cover your hand? Some of you, did He cover your wallet too? Did He cover your legs so you can walk out and move with Him? Did the Holy Ghost get all over you, or did it just get a little sprinkle on top of the head? Was it just a little salt? No. And so when we talk about baptismo, we're talking about being completely submerged. When you were saved, God did that for you. Turn over, and the rest of the message today is in Romans chapter 6. Romans chapter 6. Those are three things that are false teachings about baptism. But now here is the most precious. I love the truth in the Word of God, don't you? Do you hold to the truth of the Word of God? The truth? When you were baptized, baptism shows physically what has happened supernaturally inside of you. It is a picture of the death of the flesh, of your body and your soul. And it is a picture of the Spirit which has now come alive to God once again. How many of you feel like you're dead in your spirit here today? How many of you feel like you don't have a relationship with God today? It's kind of dead. It's kind of broken down. Well, folks, if this happened to you, what happened to you here in Romans 6 actually occurred, then you're going to feel different. Look here, Romans chapter 6, verses 1 through 3, it says, what shall we say then? Shall we continue in sin that grace may abound? God forbid. How shall we that are dead to sin live any longer therein? Know ye not that so many of us were baptized, baptismo, submerged into Jesus Christ. Were baptized, submerged into His death. We were, our flesh died. When Jesus' Holy Spirit came upon us, when we were saved, that declaration to take place, and now the outworking of that fact is the baptism. Now one man said this, he said, if all you see in Romans 6 is water, you have totally missed the point. You have totally missed the point. I heard a song by Randy Travis. Anybody heard of Randy Travis? Some people may have heard of him. He's a fella around here. Sings a song. But he sung a song called Pray for the Fish. You may have heard that? Pray for the fish. Now, I'm going to read just a few lines. He says, he's talking about this guy named Eddie Lee Vaughn. And they was like, my goodness, if he got saved, they surely ain't nobody else could have got saved. I mean, he's a rough guy. But this is what it says. Everybody gathered where the river runs wider at the edge of town to see if that Eddie Lee Vaughn baptism was really going to go down. Folks bet their hard-earned money that water wouldn't change a thing. They set the odds at 100-1 his soul wouldn't ever come clean. Then the preacher said, people take a moment or two, there's something we need to do. Pray for the fish. They won't know what's coming when the sin starts rolling off the likes of him. Lord be with them. They ain't done nothing. People, won't you leave them just a little bit of room to swim? Pray for the fish. Well, folks, that's so theologically wrong, you just can't understand it. That's theologically wrong. But there was a time when you got saved that you were baptized into that Holy Spirit and you were baptized into Jesus' death. You died when you got saved. I remember when I was a kid, I come up to the altar and I come down there and it was just like complete release. Everything was let go and I give it all to Him. And I felt like I'd been cleaned. And I bet you, if all the sins that I've ever done, even past that time, fell off me right then, you better pray for everybody in that congregation. Folks, that's what it's like. When you're baptized by the Holy Ghost, that's what it does to you. It pulls that away. And what we're going to do here will be a picture of what has already occurred, an outworking, showing. So you can't see the spiritual world. You can't see that. But when we do baptism, we're showing what's already occurred within your heart. Your flesh has literally died. They marched Scott Ingram to Calvary. In Adam, I sinned to death, but in Christ, I died to sin. I shared a video, and it must have hit a really hot point this weekend, of J. Harold Smith. It went completely viral. It's had thousands upon thousands upon thousands of views, shared all over the place. I've never seen anything like it. I had 600 people that had liked the Radio Bible Hour Facebook page, and in 2 days I had over 1,000 people that had already liked the page after I shared this video. You know what it tells in it? He looks up and he begins to talk about sin. But he don't just say sin. He points out sins. He talks about what sin is. You know what we're failing to do today? In love, we're failing to do is to tell people what sin is. People don't know what sin is. When I look at you and I say that you have been set free from sin, they don't understand that that's homosexuality, that's having sex outside of marriage, that is your reliance and your lack of faith. All of those different things are sin. Your hatefulness, your greed, your wickedness. Your thoughts that I'd like to kill that old person over there. All of them things have been, and he says here that we don't continue in that anymore. We've been set free from that. So that's the great truth. Our flesh has died. But our spirit is living in Christ. Look at verses 4 through 5. He says, therefore we are buried with Him by baptism into death. What that like as Christ was raised up from the dead, by the glory of the Father, even so we also should walk in newness of life. For if we have been planted together in the likeness of His death, we shall be also in the likeness of His resurrection. When I immerse that person into the water, it's a picture of that spiritual rebirth. Today is kind of a funeral service, folks. It's kind of a funeral service showing that your spirit's come to life. Jesus died and He didn't stay in the grave, did He? When I drop these people down, we're showing what's already occurred. But folks, I just feel like we need to understand that we need to let go of this sin. We need to let go of it. Let it... If you walk in the Spirit, you shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh. How many times do we walk in the Spirit? How many times do we let that Spirit inside guide us rather than our own soul, than our own body, our own desires, our own wants? If the Spirit was guiding us, would we have any trouble making sure that everything went on perfectly in this church if the Spirit was guiding us constantly? Huh? Would we? Would there be any problem whatsoever if we were all being led by the Spirit constantly? But you know what we do? We let that old flesh have control again. We let it speak to us more than we let the Spirit that has been brought to life inside of us speak to us. Do you understand that? Do you understand how terrible that is, that Jesus Christ died on a cross? That He took the judgment of God on you, and yet you're still listening to your old nasty flesh that He died to get rid of? Do you understand that? Do you understand the magnitude of that? You say, your flesh has died. Reckon it dead. Your spirit is now alive in Christ if ye be in Christ. Look down here at Romans 6, verses 6 and 7. He says, knowing this, that our old man is crucified with Him. That's that old flesh. That's your old desires. It's crucified with Him that the body of sin might be destroyed. That henceforth we should not serve sin. For he that is dead is freed from sin. That's pretty clear, isn't it? Your flesh was crucified. Matthew 16, verses 24 and 25, Jesus was looking at His disciples and He said this, if any man will come after Me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow Me. For whosoever will save his life shall lose it. And whosoever will lose his life for My sake shall find it. Now that little word life in there, I found it very interesting. In Greek, it's a word called psyche. And there's times in the Scripture that it's called the soul. Did you know that you are a soul? You are a soul? You know, you... When it's not just talking to your body when He talks to us. We are a soul that has a body, and inside of that there's a spirit. But to people who aren't saved, their spirit's dead. They have no connection with God. Their spirit is dead. And so when He's saying that, He's saying whosoever will save his soul shall lose it. And whosoever will lose his soul for My sake will find it. Your soul is those things inside of you. It's your ideas. It's that mental thing. You know, some people don't have a filter like that. They just let everything out, right? You ever met somebody like that? They just let everything out? Well, some of it, inside there, you are you. That's who you are. That goes on. Even when the body's dead, that soul goes on. And you've got to say, I'm going to let myself be put aside that Christ may be given the preeminence. Isn't He supposed to be given the preeminence in everything? Everything? And so He says here in another verse in John 12, Jesus said, verily, verily, I say unto you, except a corn of wheat shall fall on the ground and die, it abideth alone. But if it die, it bringeth forth much fruit. He that loveth his life shall lose it, and he that hateth his life in this world shall keep it unto life eternal. Folks, the flesh must die. You got to reckon it dead. I can't make that any more clear. Look at verses 8 through 12 here in Romans 6, finally. Now if we be dead with Christ, we believe that we shall also live with Him, knowing that Christ, being raised from the dead, dieth no more. Death hath no more dominion over Him. For in that He died unto sin once. But in that He liveth unto God. Likewise, reckon ye also yourselves to be dead indeed unto sin, but alive unto God through Jesus Christ our Lord. Let not sin therefore reign in your mortal body, that ye shall obey it in the lust thereof. Did you hear all the knowing and the reckoning? You'd think you was in the South reading that verse, wouldn't you? Well, I reckon it's this way and I reckon it's that way, right? How many of y'all say that? Well, when they speak that way in the King James English and they're talking about reckoning, they're not just saying, I guess, or anything. They're saying, I'm making it certain that I believe that God has taken care of this sin within my life. How many of y'all are still wrestling with things? Anger, jealousies, greed. How many of you still wrestle with them things? Yet you ain't reckoning that they're dead. You're letting something live that don't need to be living. You've been, like Romans 12 says, they bring a sacrifice and they put it on the altar. The thing about those living sacrifices that it says there, they like to squirm off, don't they? Folks, we need to reckon it dead. Reckon it dead and work it out here today at this altar, folks. Let it be gone. Get on God's program and get off my program. Get off what I want. Let my soul be dead and let Him work through me through His Spirit. I've been reading a book by Watchman Nee. I really enjoy it. And he made this quote. He said, "Do we realize that the basic condition for a spiritual walk is to fear ourself and its wisdom and to rely absolutely upon the Spirit?" You want to have a victorious Christian life? It ain't by watching Joel Osteen. It's by living by the Spirit. Letting the Spirit give you the direction that you need. Right now, we're going to have a moment. And some of you are going to hear in your spirit God speaking to you, telling you to come to this altar and pray. Like I said, this isn't just a baptism service. This is a service to our holy God. You need to do what God is telling you to do in your spirit. Listen to your spirit. Listen to what God wants you to do. Maybe it's to pray. Maybe it's to pray for somebody else. Maybe it's to receive salvation. Praise God. Maybe it's to ask to join the church. Come forward and say, "Well, I want to be baptized too. I want to be..." Or, "Have you been saved?" Okay. Folks, that's what it's all about. But we need to listen to the Spirit and quit listening to ourselves. Amen. Amen. Quit listening to yourself and listen to the Spirit. Let's stand. Let's get a song.
If you need to speak with someone about what was discussed in this sermon, you can find our phone number at our church's Facebook page, or we would love for you to come meet us at one of our regular meetings in person. Sunrise is located directly off exit 23 off of Interstate 81 in Tennessee. We regularly meet Sunday mornings at 10 a.m. for small group Bible studies and then at 10:50 a.m. for worship. We also meet Sunday evenings for worship at 6:30 p.m. and Wednesday nights for discipleship training at 6:30 p.m. We would love for your family to meet our family, and again, thank you for watching and sharing with others.